continue. Okay, so that's why I want to spend a little bit more time making you appreciate those technologies, with me guiding you on what are the possible issues and challenges that might have these kind of technologies are dealing with. Excuse me. Of course, we're impressed, but we want to know what's the principle behind those movements, okay, or behind those behavior. Of course, in any, it will be based on something, yeah? And I think the principle itself is not that complicated. Of course, the integration of all these things will be impressive, will be very, very complicated, but the rule of thumb or the principle behind certain scenarios will be based on not complicated things, but on simple things. Just like the way I mentioned about the targets, yeah? And so in the first two slides, and the few videos, we were more concentrated on humanoid, of course, because humanoids are very complex robots. They have more joints compared to just the arms, okay? So that's why I want you to appreciate that they're able to move like humans. And the next one is some ideas from Japan, and then the four-legged robot from MIT, the cheetah robot from MIT. And now we went to Sophia. Sophia will be more of an AI robot. Yeah, you know, more of an AI. I'm sure you have heard of her. She's not doing anything physical. She's just a brain. It's a study about the human brain. So she'll be more appropriate in our previous course in machine learning and artificial intelligence. But I've shown her here because, you know, it is important to know that part of robotics work is artificial intelligence, motion itself. The decision that it needs for the decision making ability of robots in moving, it can be considered artificial intelligence. Okay, movement entails some kind of intelligence, and having that decision making on how to move will be part of robotic control. Okay, but for now, when we talk about Sophia is more of artificial intelligence fully, and no movement. And people just trying to experiment. Scientists are trying to experiment on how to improve her brain processes, so that she will be talking like a human being, interacting like a human being, and trying to learn like a human being. And even can be more advanced than a human being. And some people are saying that probably she's more advanced now. They're just not saying, telling us. But I'm not sure, you know.
Would you like to meet her?
Yeah, bring her up, please. Oh my goodness, are you kidding?
Hi, little Sophia.
Hi, Jimmy.
You are
so cute.
You're pretty cute too.
I get that a lot when I say you're cute. Then. I get that a lot.
I wish I could take you home.
Someday soon we can. Just go to hansonrobotics.com to see how I'm doing.
I'm going to, okay. I will do that, okay, little Sophia? I'm going to put you back down then. Okay. You scared me as well as that. Give it up for little Sophia, everybody. Bye bye. I love that. Sophia, I heard the first thing.
Okay, so the nice thing about Sophia, of course, is the way she answers questions, and also her facial expression. That's part of the package, that she'll be able to smile and say some emotion in what she's saying.
You can do that. I hear that you can sing.
Yes, I love to sing karaoke using my new artificial intelligence voice. We should sing something together. Got any songs in mind?
Say something by Christina Aguilera.
Okay, I just downloaded it. I'm ready to sing.
Okay. Ruth, you know the song?
Is
are now the first ever robot human duet in the history of the Tonight Show. Ooh.
I don't know how real is that. But I have to skip because I'm not sure.
Let's get all my robots back here. That's all the time we have for tonight's Showbotics.
Okay. Anyway, yeah. Of course, Sophia is not more of a anything out of manipulation, is more of intelligence only, and she should be able to interact with humans. That's the nice thing, and that's what impressive about her. Okay, and next, I just show these dancing robots.
You broke my heart.
Because they're showing the agility of the joints, and how, of course, we have seen that video of the police or soldier robots, is showing this to be a more friendly one.
You didn't even.
From the same company, Boston Dynamics.
Want me around. And now I'm back to let you know I can really shake them down.
Well, my observation here is that you see their legs are always bent like that. There are some issues here that they're not telling us. They're still not upright like human. The soldiers before were quite upright. Okay, maybe those soldiers are much more advanced than this one. This one may have an issue of balancing. That's why they bend those legs like that, not like humans. Because this is the earlier humanoid version, this modern, different than that soldier robot.
Watch me now.
But that one, that jumping, is quite a very complicated move. This one, yeah, jumping and twisting, that's a difficult move.
Watch me now.
That one also, trying to balance. Okay, humanoids, one of the biggest challenges is balancing. Trying to balance with one leg. There. Yeah, that's a very complicated move. Yeah, look at the dog. This is also balancing. That's a difficult maneuver. Two legs are up and only balancing with two legs here. Okay, and of course this one, they're just showing off the balancing capability. This one is built the same as the other robot, lifting one leg and balancing and then doing twisting. Okay, this is another robot. I don't know if you have seen it. This is a warehouse robot. And it's used already in warehouses. And if you see that, you know, in airports, they have like this. You have seen that in airports, they have a scooter, where people with the police officer will ride it. It's the same principle. You only use two wheels, and then it try to save space. But the problem, it could be a problem. It needs to balance by itself. So you need this counterweight to balance whatever movement it does in order to, so that here it can balance and here it can also balance. So this one will try to move around so that it can maintain that upright the posture. See, it tried to balance the counterweight, we try to balance on how the other part moves so that it will maintain a balance and upright posture. OK,
Okay, see, that's difficult. This is a difficult balancing act for the humanoid. These are balancing, you know, they're just showing a dance, but the show is really how these robots can balance themselves. Yeah, those movements, they're quite. I would see this Boston Dynamics dance, the African dance, where you bend very close to the ground, right? You have this that dance like, what is this? Amapiano. The Amapiano dance where you move very close to the ground. Yeah, I want to see that in the Boston Dynamics dance. Okay. Anyway, it's done. And then what's the last one that I want to show you? The last one is about robot surgery. So everything was, we're talking about security for the soldiers. The other one is flexibility of the joints for the four-legged robot, and then AI of Sophia, and then balancing act with Boston Dynamics again. And this is Da Vinci robot for surgery. So.
Good morning. This is a case of.
This guy must be from India.
Robotic appendectomy for a patient who has the acute appendicitis.
Yeah, it's India.
This patient has severe adhesion, and there were several previous episodes of the appendicitis. This is a young girl.
So the Da Vinci robot is supposed to be surgery over the internet. That was the first principle, but they realized it is not possible. So eventually it can be as an artifact. Now you have a station like this where the surgeon will be there and moving around the hands using these controls. Yeah, these are like haptics. Yeah, haptics in terms of a reverse force control movement. So they will help in moving the instruments inside the human body. So this is an isolated station. Then it goes to the robot is.
The patient was previously managed conservatively, and now we are doing the robotic appendectomy.
Okay. Of course, these are small. You see, this is the inside already, and these are small. Probes that goes into the body of the person, but outside are huge robots. They didn't show it here. Okay, very huge robots, and there's small extension that goes into the body. So the selling point of Da Vinci robot is the minimally invasive surgery. So you don't open a huge incision in the person or in the patient, but it can afford small incisions and then go into these probes and together with the instruments inside the human body to create a surgery. Some people say it's not really that effective. Other people, it's not as effective as the open surgery where the surgeon will open and does things, but probably because the technology is still quite early and still have to progress and also, address some basic issues that for sure in the future it will be much more. I'm positive that in the future it will be much more efficient and much more useful. So they have here the scissors and they cut through the flesh by heat.
See inside a lot of adhesion.
See, these are holders. There's a small clip that will hold the human tissue.
All around the omentum is adhered. This is the fallopian tube here. This is the appendix. This is the triangle of doom, iliac vest.
They're doing appendectomy, so removing the appendix of the person.
External iliac artery and vein. appendix is inflamed and it is adhered with the omentum all around. These all are adhesions, which is clearly visible.
See, these are holders, like pliers, small pliers.
And right now also she is in acute attack. So we have the bipolar and right side seizures. And seizures is also, but seizures are not cutting, the jaws are closed and it is hooking the appendix up.
It's just holding.
And on the left side, this is a bipolar Marillac.
So it's the surgeon that's
Ovidian,
it's the surgeon that's holding
radio frequency
it.
Generated.
So it's the surgeon that is controlling this one.
That has a very high. Now here the bipolar is just holding and the seizures is cutting the coagulated area. Seizures we have not attached with the monopolar because that can create direct coupling, capacitive coupling or insulation failure. So we are only using the current in the left hand instrument and that is also bipolar. Seizures is also in the Da Vinci, you can use the bipolar.
Although in the Da Vinci. You see the smoke? It's cutting by heat.
So we are only using the current in the left hand instrument and that is also bipolar. Seizures is, although in the Da Vinci, you can use the bipolar and monopolar at the same time. And you can use seizures, monopolar seizure also to cut. But in this case, we are using the seizures as a mechanical cutting instrument, not with the electrosurgery. And slowly these adhesions has been removed.
You see, the nice thing about the heat, they cut it and they close it at the same time. No need for, I think there's no need to do some, like, what is this, stitching?
Now, these are the last three of the omental adhesions and it is separated. Now, we have to dissect the major appendix.
See, no blood. You see it? It's removed and no blood.
Separated. Now we have to dissect the major appendix. Here the bipolar is cooking the major appendix for current 0.25 lakh rupees and all the instruments are only 10 use like 16,000. Know that in the dark can slow the challenge but you can just pull it like that and then you can try to tie the knot over the cecum and automatically it will slip to the junction there.
There, imagine, you know, you're a surgeon and then you try to do the knot inside.
One of the important thing in the robotic surgery, as we know that we don't have tactile feedback. So when you are tightening the knot at that time, you have to be moderate. Otherwise you can break the suture also. Or if,
yes,
if you will leave it, then it will be loose. So during the intracorporeal suturing, a moderate experience, with the experience, you can decide. Now this is the second knot, and this is 2-1-1. First time outside. Double wrap, two opposite alternatives.
It's time to wait. I have a class.
Yeah. And here the bipolar, you have to be really careful because bipolar has this is a soft instrument. And now this is a knot, tightened. And then this is second one. I can apply two knots and you can cut in between. But here we will use bipolar to see.
If you know the tactile feedback, that's what one of the major limitations of the Da Vinci robot. Tactile feedback meaning that the surgeon doesn't know exactly how doesn't feel anything. Okay, that is a feedback from what he is doing. So he will only see everything from the camera, but no force feedback. He doesn't feel anything.
Feel, and that way you may not apply the second knot. Generally,
and that's the major complaint of most surgeons, because in surgery, the tactile, the feedback from the force feedback or tactile feedback is a major sense for the robot, for the surgeon to know whether what they're doing is proper or not. Okay, without that, it will be very difficult for them to judge. And that's why that's the major limitation of the Da Vinci robot. He said it's not the usual kind of surgical environment that they're used to because there's no tactile feedback.
The three knots if you are tying, then there will be a necrosis area between the second and third. This is bipolar, you know, this is good. And from the other side, scissors is cutting. We are not using monopolar with the scissors. It is just mechanical cut. And now the appendectomy is complete. If you are expecting any fecal leak,
there, the appendix is cut. Okay, with very very small incision, very small blood coming.
One of the 8 mm port. The major appendix is minimum, so there will be no any entrapment of the tissue. Otherwise, you can use endobag also. So this was just a simple case of the acute appendicitis and where the robotic surgery is being performed. Thank you very much for watching this video.
Okay, done. We're done with all those videos. Okay, so throughout all those videos, what I want you to appreciate is that robotics is some kind of an research on intelligence. Okay, why is it called intelligence when some of those movements does not necessarily require AI, okay, or like artificial intelligence that we know about? Well, it's because of the basic principle that when things move, there we can. The major requirement of things that are moving is the brain, because when you move, it requires some kind of a decision-making process, and that decision-making process make things intelligent. Okay, that is the reason why animals or insects have brains compared to plants. They don't have brains. Okay, because they don't move, they just stay in one. They don't need to make decisions. When you move, you need to make decisions. Well, maybe some insects. I don't know if leeches have brains, maybe. I'm not sure. Okay, so some, as you go down slowly, smaller organisms, maybe they don't have brains. They only have a nervous system that can help them decide, that can help them react, not decide, but react to stimulus. So in this case here, this is an example that is given by another professor. I'll copy the example. Is the tunicates, this one tunicates, it's like a sea organism or a sea animal. I'm not sure, okay. But also in the sea, there's some kind of, you can say it's an animal, it's a plant. But anyway, so this tourniquet, it's moving around, but once it decides, while it's moving, it has brains. Once it decides to settle in one place, then they will eat their own brains, okay. Once it grows like a plant like that, it will eat its own brains and there's no more brains. So it's like saying that now that it's going into a stationary position and no need to move, then it doesn't have brains. So because movement, motion is a driving force for development of intelligence. So because of the decision-making process and planning when you plan to move. And of course, the perception of your environment and how you represent that space, the spatial representation of your environment for you to maneuver for you to explore or navigate that environment, whether the whole body navigation or the end of the arm navigating. So in the case of manipulation, okay, a manipulation or just the arm only, or manipulation where you interact with the environment, it requires knowledge of the real world. And so this kind of knowledge requires intelligence. And so it requires you, so we say that robot itself has some form of intelligence, okay? Whether you're using AI or just purely motion control itself, it has some intelligence embedded into it so that it can make decisions, okay? So that is the, I think this is the end of the first lecture. And then I will continue with the second lecture. Okay. Ah, it's already 12. Okay, one more hour, right? We start at 11 and we finish at 1 o'clock. Okay. So let's continue. Okay, so this is lecture two. So we define some basic definitions in robotics and say that robotics, can you read this one, Mr. Boaho?
Robotics Robotics is an interdisciplinary branch of engineering and science that includes mechanical engineering, electronic engineering, information engineering, computer science, and others.
Okay, and continue.
Robot motion planning. To find a sequence of valid configurations that move the robot from the source to destination.
Okay, so this class is about robot motion planning. And to do that, we need to know the of robotic control. Who's that? Okay, hold on. Hello, good morning.
Hello, Dimana.
Yes.
Loading.
Sorry, I have a, who is this, please?
Okay, my name is Mercedes. I'm calling from Brandlot
Station. Ah, sorry, I have a class. Sorry. Okay. So, sorry for that. So robotics, as we know, is an integration of many engineering disciplines. So mechatronics is not mentioned here, but mechatronics is mechanical as well as electronics in the literal sense. But robotics itself is a combination of more than mechatronics, of course, like information system and computer science, and also mechanical and electronic engineering. So that's why it is a little bit more. We can say that it's a little bit more advanced. The students need to have more advanced exposure to many engineering disciplines, interdisciplinary exposure, to be able to survive in mechatronics or robotics program, because it is necessary because of the requirement that there is some sense of intelligence. That has a software component in it, and some controls part, which is electronics and mechanical, of course, the design and how these things are moving. Okay, and so for the robot motion planning, we will consider the control on how to start from to move from start or the start location or the source to the destination location or the goal location. So that is our major objective in this class. But for the most part, we will be using arms, because we will not be using discussing humanoids and legged robots. We will use arms to discuss motion planning. So we will discuss how these arms or the hand of the robot, which is the one that manipulates the world, compared to the posture of the rest of the arm in order to achieve its goal. So how the posture will navigate through and bring the hand somewhere in order to manipulate and interact with the environment. That is our major goal in this class. And to do that, then we need to discuss a basic computation, matrix computations on how to achieve them, and linear algebra, okay? So, the basic question is, how do rigid bodies move? Okay, so there are two types of motion that rigid bodies move. One is translational motion, which is the position change in the X, Y, and Z direction. For example, up and down, left and right, and move forward and back. Okay, and this is three dimensional because of the three independent axes. So normally red is the x-axis, RGB corresponds to X, Y, and Z axis. So R is this is one axis. I mean, red is one axis, which is X, could be right is positive and left can be negative. And then green is the Y axis and the blue is the Z axis. So in this case, there's a 3D environment. So we say that the world in this case has a 3D environment where things can be positioned, yeah? But it is not enough in the robotics point of view. There's another axis or another movement, another degree of freedom that we need to be considering. And that is the rotation, the rotational movement or the rotational motion. And these will be the rotations of each of those axes. So now, for example, the same thing in the R, G, and B. So this is red. So there's a rotation. Positive rotation by right-hand rule, okay? When you go like that, okay, this is the positive the thumb is the direction of the positive axis by right hand rule. And if you can go like that with the thumb, so this movement, this rotation is positive, okay? If you go around that axis and the positive direction is in that direction. So this is a positive movement. That means that if you turn in the other direction, turn like that, that's a negative rotation, okay? That means that you're rotating like that, that means you're rotating like this. By the right-hand rule, you're rotating down, rotating here, that means the axis direction is in the negative direction. So now that's a negative rotation by the right-hand rule. So the same thing as here. So here it could be the X positive direction, the red is there. And so moving plus moving in this direction is positive and moving in the other direction is negative. Okay, please be comfortable with that. So always is the right-hand rule to say which direction you are moving. You point to the positive direction and see if it can turn in that way. If not, if you can do that, then there's positive rotation. And then if not, then you point your thumb to the negative direction. If you can turn like that, then that's the negative. There's a negative rotation. Okay. So thus in the robot motion planning, we say that it is not just, the world is not just a three-dimensional world, but actually six-dimensional. Okay. So there are three additional dimensions in terms of rotation, because we are not just interested in moving to a point, but also knowing the orientation of that object in the space. For example, I use my phone, I put my phone at this point in the 3D space, but that is not enough information. I need to know the information of how the phone is rotated. Is it rotated like that? Is oriented? Is it oriented like this? Oriented like that? You see, I am on the same location. I am in the same position, but there is an orientation, or the independent orientation with the orientation like this rotation, or like this rotation, or like that rotation. Okay. So there's three more independent axes in order to define the rotation of that object in space. So always remember, you have three dimensions in translation and additional three dimensions in rotation. Okay, so thus the motion of rigid bodies will be, we say, it can be considered as purely translational or purely in terms of a point movement where you move in the X, Y, and Z axis, or in this case here, this point and this object moves in that object in that direction. Okay, although there can be some kind of rotation. Excuse me. Although there can be some kind of rotation, in this case, you see this object is not a point, but it's moving translational only. There's no change in rotation. So that's a purely translational movement. So in the case of the cat going after the rat, okay, the fastest way to move is by a straight line, as you know. So in this case, they're moving purely translational because the rat needs to move as fast as possible. But in this case, it's not confusing the cat yet. But it can go around to confuse the cat. That's another story. Okay. So if you consider pure rotation, this one we have already shown in the previous slide. So in the airplane, of course, we say there's roll, pitch, and yaw. Okay. Roll is when your wings roll like this. Roll, that means a rotation of the X. Yeah, that's the X moving forward. That's the nose of the plane. Okay, that's roll. And the pitch is the Y. Pitch is a, you know, pitch. You know why it's called roll? Yeah? You know? Well, because you're rolling, see? You're rolling. That's roll, yeah? Okay. And then pitch is this one, the y-axis is moving up and down from the nose. It nose up or nose down, that's pitch. You know why it's called pitch? When you go up and down the plane, you know? Come on, you don't know? Okay, its pitch because, you know, the sound changes pitch when you open or close a diaphragm, yeah? It's like opening and closing the diaphragm. That's why pitch, you know, you open more, the sound becomes more and more, and then you close and the sound becomes sharper and sharper. Of course, you can go downward like that. So it changes the pitch if you go up and down, okay? And then, you know why yaw is moving like this? It's called yaw. No? Because when you turn like that, you say, yo, like that, no? When you turn, yo, you make a sound like that, yeah? You don't know, okay? Those are the major reasons why it's called all pitch and yo, for you to remember, okay? Okay, the other one is this is called a Stewart platform. A Stewart platform is quite of a unique mechanism, okay? That is a purely translational movement. Is translational, that means moving in the straight line of this support in the platform. Of this normally is driven by hydraulics, okay? It could be a stage, you know, a huge stage and driven by hydraulics that will rotate the stage only on its location, yeah, by moving the supports, yeah. So if you combine the movement of the support, you will also achieve independent roll, pitch, and yaw motion. It's called a Stewart platform, okay? So in all this, instead, of course, these are highly dedicated movement, which doesn't happen in the real world. I mean, you cannot have, it's very rare that you can have a purely translation and purely rotational motion. In the real world, it's a combination of both. So you can say translation and rotation of this, I think this is the turtle bot. The turtle bot is one of the basic turtle robot. It's a turtle robot in ROS that they use to control to show that ROS is the robot operating system, which is the simulation platform for robotics.